If you guys don't mind, I have a question already prepared, and anyone can reply. So really, my question is, and it resonates with all of your presentations, really. It's so in the SDG community forum, you said that you identified a couple of SDGs that you wanted to prioritize for that project. So where does that come from? How can communities really come together to identify these priorities, right? Because priorities for different communities are going to be different. And the data can say so much. How do we bring in people's voices and experiences and let those serve as the baseline for creating priorities for that community? What can you share in terms of best practices or ways that people can mobilize from different communities and different lived experiences so that when you identify priorities, they're really representative of that community? And also making sure that whatever you do prioritize is somehow connected to all of the other SDGs, right? Because they're all interconnected. And when you make progress on one, you end up making progress on so many others. So do you guys have any insights around that?
Yeah, I can share. I could start first. So the process that we took with the community forum, specifically the 2019 one, was really to bring together so many different people from within the community, representing First Nations, governments, like NGOs, general community members. So we had a big call out for anyone who wants to come and share with us. And then we had a two-day forum where we educated people on what the Sustainable Development Goals are, because, you know, so many people are very passionate and are doing such amazing work when they don't know what SDGs are. Like, it can be a really real barrier with the language and that kind of thing. So just really focusing on that without having to use the SDG language, but also educating them at the same time. So that is super important, is like meeting people where they're at and allowing them to make those connections themselves. Asking for their feedback, like what do you think is most important and why, and what are the connections? And I think that was the most important way of going about it. You know, I think we are continuing to educate the community on this. You know, a two-day forum might not be accessible for everyone, so, you know, continuing to share the work and engage other organizations so that they can engage with their, you know, audience and the people that they're engaging in the community. So also, yeah, creating that space for people to come together though is really important, because a lot of time we were doing all of this great work in silos and we don't know what other people are doing and where the connections are. So facilitating that space for everyone to make those connections, come together, identify our priorities is so important. I'll stop there. Does anyone, Will or Margaret, have anything to add? I love that question, Eliana. Thank you so much.
I mean, I very much agree with what Shay has said. For these workshops that I'm leading, it's very much about feedback and getting the voices of teachers and students heard from Google Forms that we sent out and seeing what their needs are. And so we're meeting those needs. And what's really surprising is that a lot of people don't know what the SDGs are, and it's not a topic being taught in schools. So it's very much breaking down that barrier and really making it seem like it's not so daunting for students, especially younger students, to understand it, because it's actually a very simple concept. It's 17 goals and it's, you know, climate change, water. It's very, very easy for anyone to understand. But I think the way that it's portrayed in the media and in other sources on the UN website, it's not exactly very accessible to a lot of people. So and also making it, you know, fun and, you know, having games and interactive components to workshops, you know, it really helps to break down that barrier that, you know, exists. So I very much agree with what Shay has said. So I'll pass it to Will if he has anything to add.
Will, are you still there? You might be on mute. Well, while Will is chiming in, I just want to say that I completely agree with your answers. I think that, first of all, the idea that you've educated them about the SDGs and you're sharing that awareness and making sure that people just understand how these goals are unifying and ways that they can use them, but bring in their own input to advance their local initiatives and their local priorities. I think that's really key to kind of have the global and bringing it back into the local. Plus, nowadays with Zoom and with the fact that everything's online, we've kind of gone a step further when it comes to accessibility, right? Accessing these community forums. I think technology, in a way, has been able to help us mobilize even more people around the table, bring in even more insight and more experiences. So luckily, I see new opportunities in the future to really expand that process and to see priorities coming from communities and priorities really showing the uniqueness of each community and having the SDGs really mold from a framework that was designed by most countries in the world to something that is very unique to a community and that it's serving. Absolutely. So thank you so much. Will, before I move on to the next question, I just want to check in and see if you've come back.
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, my video is off because the connection is better. Anyways, but yes, that's a great question. Like, how do you connect with your community? How do you get that feedback and get authenticity? And I think that both Shay and Margaret said it like perfectly. It's about like listening in and meeting people where they're at specifically for accessibility needs. Ending off trying.
Will, your audio is a little bit. We can't hear you very well, Will. Do you mind repeating that last part?
Yeah. Yes. I think the last part was meeting other people where you're at and being honest about all the things that you know and all the things that you don't know and being honest with that too.
I love that honesty. Absolutely. I mean, where would we be without honesty, right? We can't create anything meaningful or have meaningful dialogue without pure honesty from all walks of life and lived experience. And that's what serves a very rich way forward for each community in its own unique way. Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to check the chat to see if we have any questions from the audience. Also, if anyone would like to ask in person, you can raise your hand. And oh, we have someone raising their hand. Oh, Bella. Hi, Bella. All right.
Thank you. So first of all, thank you for all the three presenters, Shay, Margaret, and Will. It's very it's very impactful to hear all your stories. My question kind of builds on what we just said about being honest and meeting people where they're at. So for our organization, the Jingurong Institute, we are trying to engage with youth on a lot of the same issues that you have raised, and the whole leave no one behind and ensure when we do our work, there's representation of a wide range of youth. What recommendations would you give for organizations to do that, to ensure this representation without tokenizing? Because I find it's a bit of a fine line to make sure you have somebody from different groups identified differently to talk about the work, but without just, you know, making sure that it's a very tokenistic way. So any advice you could give on that would be great. Thanks.
Yeah, great question.
I just want to ask a follow-up question. Is the youth that you are engaging, is that across Canada or is it a specific area?
Across Canada.
Yeah, that's definitely tricky, I would say. So you're wanting to engage youth broadly on like a specific topic or?
Yeah, so our programs with youth is getting youth engaged in very similar, the intersection of climate change, biodiversity laws, environmental inequity. We're trying to weave in Indigenous perspectives through all of that. And so when we're either putting things on social media or asking for speakers, we want to have different youth voices represented. But again, just trying to be mindful of not putting the burden of that work only on, let's say, BIPOC youth or marginalized groups or the groups that we try not to leave behind. So how do you balance being inclusive of their voice without adding that work that can be sometimes burdensome? And like I said, not being tokenistic about it, but trying to do it despite intentions, right? Like, I think it's also then what the result is. We just want to avoid any potential negative results or the do no harm principle.
Thank you so much. That is an excellent question and excellent work that you're setting out to do. So my first, as a youth that is engaged in a lot of different things, being Indigenous, you know, I've felt that a lot. And the spaces where I don't feel that is when people are honest and transparent. Really, and you explain everything that you want to do, your intentions, and you ask in a way that you would ask anyone else, and engage with them in a way that you would anyone else, because they are bringing their knowledge and experience and expertise, and you know, they're never too young to share what they have to offer. So I think that it's really important to like have reciprocal relationships. Like, a lot of people are like, yeah, I want to engage you, and what you're getting back is like just your exposure. And I'm like, I don't need exposure. Like, I need to pay my bills, you know. Like, I think that is really important to pay people equitably for their time and their energy, and also for engaging different people. So for the Gender Equality Project and for the SDG project, we have a really good steering team. So we have people that know people within the community that are from a broad range of different areas. So we brought together a steering team to guide the way that we're doing that work. And I know that, you know, time and money or project deadlines can be a barrier to like convening a steering team like that, but I would really suggest that that's a good way to go to get other people's insights, because a lot of times being the coordinator on this, like it's heavy, it's a lot to try and just do it yourself. So, you know, engaging other people, other organizations. So I would say for like a cross Canada kind of call out, reach out to organizations who are engaging these people already and have a broad range of people and like partner with those organizations, like compensate them a little bit for their time for reaching out to participants. And like maybe having an application kind of process that might help find the right person for what you're doing. And also being like the only, you know, Indigenous person in a lot of spaces, like it's nice to have multiple people to avoid that tokenization, that feeling of being alone, like even if it's just two people, so that they can, you know, talk about it together and share how they're feeling about that kind of thing. I think is really important, not just to have like one of each, but like at least a couple, you know, different intersecting identities. And also recognizing that, you know, you're just speaking from your own experience. You can't speak for everyone else. Like I should have said that at the beginning, like it's just my perspective and what I can bring. Like, you know, yeah, I'm not speaking for the whole like plethora of different people, you know, like, I'll stop there. Thank you. Pass it over to Margaret or Will.
I mean, I'm just gonna add to what Shay has said. I think I completely agree. And what I wanted to add is to, you know, whatever you want to engage whatever issue you want to engage the youth in, it's really important for them to really understand the issue and make sure that you're using their language to explain it to them, because there can be misunderstandings. And things that they are not seeing from your perspective necessarily. So it's really important for you to understand what you're trying to do, but also you're trying to be in their shoes, trying to view it from their perspective when you're trying to engage with youth. Another thing I want to add is it's really, I mean, right now it's all about social media, like youth are, you know, on TikTok and all, it's kind of evolving what their interests are. So I think it's important for, you know, adults or people who are not in, you know, categorize themselves as youth to really understand, like, what are some of the main kind of influences they're kind of impacting their lives, right? And to kind of understand, like, what's sort of relevant to them, and then putting yourself in kind of their perspective to engage them, rather than, you know, setting in your own ways, having your own methodology, and then you're trying to frame them in your own kind of framework, which doesn't really work because they're evolving constantly, and you're, you know, you may have a way of doing things, but they're, you know, they're very flexible and they're adaptive and all that. So yeah, that those are the two points I wanted to raise, but I'll pass it to Will.
Yeah, I think from what I caught, the question was about engaging youth specifically without, like, tokenizing and getting that, like, yeah, and I understand, like, that line, because it's like, because a lot of it is with intention and a lot of it is with action, and so I think specifically from, I guess, a youth-ish perspective, a lot of it is also about not overcomplicating and not putting too many, I guess, systems in place. Yes, not wanting to tokenize youth. That's always a good thing. That's always a good thing to talk about. Am I frozen again?
No, you're okay. We can hear you.
I apologize so much. Okay. this question, because it shows the forethought, and I think that that's important to communicate as well, to the youth, in question, and also, like, advertising widely, because I think my biggest issue is, like, not finding the, I guess, opportunities that are at hand, and then people won't have the capacity to add them in the team. Thank you
so much, Will. I think the most powerful thing that we can do sometimes in these spaces is really have an attentive ear, whether you're gathering together to talk about SDG priorities and strategies, if you're just here to learn, sometimes having an attentive ear and really listening is, like Will said before, it can change, can make all the difference for the speaker and for the listener. So more than anything, I feel I really enjoyed listening to you guys intently and attentively. And I think that's the key message and the whole point of this session is really listen and take the time to hear what other people have to say and really bring their voices into the conversation, because everyone has such a rich, beautiful experience. So I want to thank you guys so much. And speaking of listening, we have a poem to close the session. And I do believe Will is going to be sharing that poem. So Will, if you'd like, the floor is yours before we end the session. And yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Everybody who has taken part and has attended and listened and spoken, receiving. Poem is called "The Journey." Above the mountains, the geese turn into the light again. painting the black silhouettes on an open sky. Sometimes everything has to be inscribed across the heavens, so you can find the one line already written inside of you. Sometimes it takes a great sky to find that first bright and indescribable wedge of freedom in your own heart. Sometimes the one left when the fire has gone out.
I think he asked me to read the poem, so I think he's just sending it along. Are you going to send the poem over, Will? Okay.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for your patience and understanding. The technological world is still quite difficult to navigate, but it just takes some patience.
Sorry, Will, I love your voice, but I will share this with everyone. So this poem that Will wants to share is The Journey by David White. Above the mountains, the geese turn into light again, painting their black silhouettes on an open sky. Sometimes everything has to be inscribed across the heavens, so you can find the one line already written inside you. Sometimes it takes a great sky to find that first bright and indescribable wedge of freedom in your own heart. Sometimes with the bones of the black sticks left when the fire has gone out, someone has written something new in the ashes of your life. You are not leaving. Even as the light fades quickly now, you are arriving.
That's beautiful. That's really beautiful. I got chills. That's really moving. And you know, Will, we heard a little bit from the beginning. So, I mean, both of you did such an amazing job. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. Wow, I don't want to close this session, but we're at time, so I have to. So, but thank you to all three of you so much. And thank you to everyone for joining us. You've been an incredible audience, and I've personally learned so much, and I hope you did too. In the last 5 minutes of the session, I'm going to pass it off to Anika to take a small survey and yeah, to close the session. Thank you all very much. Anika, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Eliana. It is my absolute pleasure to thank you all for joining us for the AGM and symposium to bring us to a close of this incredible week of holding space and really reflecting on the ways that we can do better. And I think what Shailen mentioned today is when we know more, we should do, when we know better, we should do better. This week has been a journey for me as well. On the topic of centering reconciliation and decolonization in the international cooperation sector, I share in my land acknowledgements that a land acknowledgement is not just a time to name the Indigenous communities on whose land you live, work, play on, but actually a framing to recognize that you, all of us, have a responsibility to stand in solidarity and learn more and do better as allies to Indigenous folks. And of course, for Indigenous people, this navigation is very different. But for those of us that, like me, are settlers, the land acknowledgement is a means to frame our engagement and to prompt us to reflect on how we're going to take part in the session, webinar, event, AGM, symposium to learn the concrete skills to better support our Indigenous brothers and sisters. And so when I think about this week, I hope that all of you have taken little bits and pieces or maybe fulsome notes away from each of our sessions to better center reconciliation and decolonization in your own work, in your own lives, in your own homes, with your families, with your siblings, with your parents, with your children, whatever that family means to you. And I really, really welcome you all to share in the chat or with us afterwards what those lessons are, or what they could be. And I know that, like Shailen mentioned, it is an uncomfortable journey. And if you're uncomfortable, it means you're probably growing, you're making space for growth. And so I hope you take time to sit with that discomfort and take time to reflect and fully, truly reflect on what this can mean, not just for you, but also for the future of our sector. So with that, it's my absolute pleasure to once again thank everyone for joining us today and throughout the week, and to invite you to take this away and sit with it and share with us what your learnings have been and what your learnings could be. And with that, I can close. Thank you all and have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.